Good afternoon and welcome to the inaugural football show here. I'm here with Rob DeArmond and William Weathers. Thank you guys for being here. We are trying the show format out as we discussed with the local football coaches about doing a coach's show. Unfortunately, we were unable to find a time where we could get everybody together to do that. So we're going to be doing this show on a weekly basis after these two guys do their interviews with the coaches, wrapping up last week, asking them what they're doing to get ready for this week. And, you know, we're going to be talking about what they said, what they intend to improve on, those sorts of things. So we appreciate you joining us for this. It's coming out, it should be Thursday afternoon, wherever you are watching or listening to. If you are watching, we hope you aren't driving. So, William, we're going to start with you. We're going to run through some of the 5A schools real quick, and then we're going to jump over to Rob for Albany and Springfield. So first and foremost, your most recent interview was with Bill Conedes at Denham Springs. I hate to put it, charmingly befuddled at what's going on. They do host Ponchatoula. No, I'm sorry. That's right. We discussed that. They are visiting Ponchatoula. Not so much worried about the defense. We'll get to that in a second. But, you know, after the game Friday, 28-0 loss, eventually defense wore out. He said they're going back to the drawing board. That was the first question you posited to him when you interviewed him this week. What does that mean?
That means trying to simplify things. That means fewer formations, fewer reads, fewer routes, collectively. The one thing they do well in terms of on paper was the offensive line returning almost intact. It means establishing a run and then kind of building off of that.
So, a lot of the things that he said sort of as an offensive guy is that, it's difficult because you can't run the formations and have the reads and situations with Mr. Luke Lunsford that he had hoped that he could.
Oh, no question. To being in the second week of the season, there's been no gradual progression from the scrimmage. They've regressed, unfortunately, for whatever reason. You can go back and look at they've turned the ball over. Three times, they actually turned the ball over four times last week, two of which were turning to touchdowns. So when they're not lining up correct or missing a route where, for example, a receiver ran the wrong route, it ended up in an interception. Things of those natures have to get cleaned up.
And talking about those fumbles, ball protection was something that he brought up with you. It's not really as stable of running backs like you can talk about at the college level. There's a big difference between a high school freshman and a junior and a senior. Well, a lot of those guys had fumbles. He did bring up his running back situation and some of the things he's going to try. Tell us about that.
Yeah, because, their offense is predicated on being able to run the ball. For his first 2 years, he had Tyree Goldman and Travion Muse, who he can hand the ball off to 18, 20 times. That has not been the case, where it's been more by committee. This week, the head of the committee will be Jalen Jenkins. Jalen had 77 yards rushing last week and had some moments, but he'll be the first guy out there Friday night.
Well, and we will be interested to see how he does. Sometimes the young guys get a shot, and they get a shot early. Now, defensively, they did give up 28 points, but that's a little misleading. He's still confident in his defense. There were 21 second-half points. A lot of times you get tired. So, talk to us about what he said about his defense.
If one area that did show marked improvement over the scrimmage in Jamboree was the defense. They really, swarmed to the ball. Tristan Dewey had 10 tackles to lead the way. They were down 7-0 in that game. Of the 28 points, two were set up by turnovers. So, they didn't drive the ball down their throats, but time of possession in terms of being on the field too much caught up with them in the second half. The offense did not sustain any type of time of possession drives, and they were on the field too much. And the end result shows that 28-0 is a little deceiving because the defense did play very well.
Yeah, and you saw a lot of that with LSU, right? They were quick to score. That defense spends a lot of time on the field, turns into a shootout. So, there may be some things about those Big 12 teams that may be a little true. Maybe they do have some defense. But, speaking of LSU, they'll have their hands full with an LSU commit quarterback, TJ Finley, who Ponchatoula's quarterback. They'll be playing him tomorrow night, so that they'll have their work cut out for him. Speaking of Mr. Finley, though, he just played Live Oak, and they did a really good job with him. Now, Live Oak is hosting Woodlawn this Friday night. We're going to kind of change it up a little bit. Let's talk about the defensive effort first. 99 total yards for Mr. TJ Finley. So, excuse me, not total. 99 passing yards for Mr. TJ Finley. No passing touchdowns. And that's with three new starters in the secondary. So, tell us what Brett Beard said about that.
He was ecstatic. That's been a point of emphasis since the spring, is how we're gonna kind of replenish the back end of the defense. You know, three new starters, as you mentioned. You know, Darian Ricard's the one constant back at corner. It all starts up front, and Jalen Lee and Kyle Kiddo and Tyler Braun getting after and putting pressure, kind of moving, you know, Finley off his spot. There were I think it was 4 to 5 sacks. And that obviously helps, you know, the secondary when the guy is not setting up and being able to kind of pick you apart. So give the way they worked in concert, communication, things of that nature, where you saw half of the game in terms of that game. And then the offense, you know, the offense ran the ball, controlled the clock, kept the defense off the field, and what you got was a very resounding first game win.
And as you said, one of the things that, you know, they're kind of riding on a big high right now, because it was a complete game effort. It came on the back of an interesting gamble right after halftime. Did he have anything to say about that outside of what he told Mr. Adam Henderson, who was our guy at the game?
In that moment, and one thing I love about, you can sense in the program, is the trust. Obviously, he felt his players could pull it off, and his players believed. It was like it was this residual where our coach believed in us, and they went and got that fumble, and the offense went down and scored. It's a two-score game, and the momentum apparently just, the crowd's going nuts, the sideline's on fire. The next thing you know, you're getting a runaway win. It just felt they needed a possession, just to let's get some momentum here, and it worked. I mean, so you give them a lot of credit. Sean Payton in the Super Bowl against the Colts, they feel like they can go get that possession. They did. And this was a similar situation. I was on a different level.
Sure. But hey, momentum's momentum in football. Makes a big difference. So moving forward, somebody that, they had their hands full last week, that would be Live Oak. They responded. Somebody that will have their hands full this week in a home game against Destrehan is Walker. As Coach Mahaffey described it to you, it's going to be a huge challenge because it's a tradition-rich school. Tell us a little bit about his introduction to the game.
This is what Chad Mahaffey was at U High, a prominent program. They built a winner, multi-time trips to the domes, state championships. Destrehan is, on the Mount Rushmore here with Zachary, Acadiana, West Monroe. And that's what Walker is ultimately achieving, striving to become. Obviously, they've got a long way to get there, but you can't beat them if you don't play them. And to their credit, they're gonna find out a lot about them. By playing them, and however this plays out, this is how the top teams, you got to get prepared to play Zachary.
Sure.
In their district. So it's a great test to see where they are in week two. They won 38-30 over Madison Prep in a game that, they started pretty well, had moments where I think there were two or three touchdowns up, and did not finish to their liking. And that's, I think, the biggest point of emphasis, is that let's try to put two complete halves together, and let's see where we stand up at the end.
He did say that they, Madison Prep pushed and his team pushed back a little bit, so he was happy with that.
Yeah, because it was just the opposite against Catholic High and the Jamboree, where things just unraveled, and it did not get pretty. Turnover after turnover, turnover. They had no answer, and it got ugly. He did like the way their kids stood up. When it got to a one score game, they were able to answer with a score or with a stop on defense. And for that, he was very happy with that improvement.
Now, talking about D1 commitments, Destrehan does have an Alabama running back.
Yeah, Kyle Edwards is going to give them quite. Now, they lose John Emery to LSU, and here comes, and that goes back to where Destrehan is in their evolution of their program. You can just plug in a guy who's going to Alabama, and apparently, he had about 83 yards last week. Not necessarily were tested, but again, yes, they're going to have to Madison Prep was a bigger threat throwing the ball. This will be a bigger physical running style of defense, how they're going to hold up against them.
So they're going to have to play tough on the defensive side.
No question. And that's how it'll be life in 4-5A. So they got to get ready to get after it Friday.
Well, thank you, sir. That will complete the 5A portion of this show. Let's move to the eastern side of the parish. However, one of those teams is coming this way and going a little farther. So we're going to start with Albany. They're going to Olympia Stadium in Baton Rouge to play St. Michael, who's one of their two 4A challengers, Beauchamp being the other. You know, one of the things that you talked about, this, we're moving over to Rob DeArmond, just in case I didn't say that. One of the things that you said that you talked to Coach Mike Janis about is, how do you recover from that marathon? So let's start with that marathon game to open a season. 68-44 win, almost a two-hour first half. So what do you tell you?
The big thing, and this was Friday after the game, you know, because you just go, Mike, well, this is – you guys played almost two games in one little part. And like I told you, you know, we're not even to halftime, and Williams tweeting out scores from the third quarter of his game.
Right.
So that's kind of the pace you're looking at. But he said the big thing is to make sure we're healthy. He stressed that they did yoga on Monday, right, you know, just to kind of keep it light. But I talked to him this morning, Thursday morning, and he said yesterday their Wednesday practice was probably one of the best practices they've had. And it was all about keeping those guys healthy because, I mean, you throw in – you've got cramping issues, of course. You're going to have them, but it was just exacerbated by the length and how much they're having to go. You know, you're looking at big plays. They, you know, Independence runs the opening kickoff back for a touchdown.
Right.
And then Albany comes back three plays later and scores, and that sets the tone for the entire night.
It's going to be a shootout. You
know? Yes, exactly.
So with this team they're facing, it's good that they had that physical practice, as we discussed in sort of our little pre-gamer for this show, because St. Michael is going to run that triple option. Got to be physical with it. Tell us what you talked about.
You know, you played football. It's assignment football. You have to know where they're going to be and what they're going to do. You have to look at a formation and say, okay, this is what they're going to try to do. And he really, and Mike really stressed that on the offensive side. Defensively, he just likes what they're doing. It's kind of a 3-3 stack, which he said they ran at times last year at Albany. And he said it's something that he'd like to, if he could, he'd incorporate it. But he just liked their pursuit to the ball. He also told me that they had three interceptions, I think, last week. And it was a 16-7 win over Episcopal.
Okay.
So, I mean, what they're trying to do offensively, too, and we haven't talked about this, but what Albany is doing this year is it's a spread tempo offense. And it's not – maybe if you've seen Albany in the past few years, it's been a wing tee, grind it out. And when they did throw the ball, it was kind of a surprise.
Right.
They're trying to throw the ball a little bit more. They got off to a 1-for-6, and 1-for-7 start passing the ball. Mike said if we do that, that's probably going to be two punts, our first two possessions. So a big key for them is getting that passing game started early and getting going early.
Well, we will see how they do against St. Michael tomorrow at Olympia Stadium. Keep an eye open for that. Springfield is our last team that we'll be talking about today, 2A, over there also on the eastern side of the parish. They have their home opener against Cohen. Not much to talk about there, but some interesting storylines coming out of that first game, really leading into a guy named Kobe Linares, who comes from Texas. So I'm going to let you take it away from here because this is fascinating.
It's a really interesting thing. So we go out and we do our stories for the football edition, and you know, we get them fairly early, and then so I let him go. We let him go about a week into camp, and then you come back out, and then so as I start talking to Coach Surpass, a couple different names start popping up, and they were kids that weren't here, and it's like, well, he transferred in from Texas, and that's his stepbrother. He's from Texas, and Kobe was one of those guys. So you kind of see how they're going to fit in. They were relying on Arshon Andrews to kind of be the guy to carry the load rushing for him. He filled in, you guys might remember, he filled in after John L. Friesen broke his leg last year.
Right.
As a freshman, did pretty well. So they're looking to him to kind of carry it. Arshon got kind of banged up a little bit in their scrimmage. So as you're sitting there, you know, Arshon kind of goes to the side to get better. And then Kobe comes in, and, you know, he told me, he said, they were just looking for me to play linebacker. But before I go do this story, I called up some clips on Huddle, and I'm looking, and Kobe at his school in Texas, he's playing linebacker, but he's also playing center.
Yeah.
So
What a transfer.
I asked Coach Surpass about that. He's like, welcome to 2A football. We have to look at guys and see where they're going to fit for us and where it's going to help us and help them.
Right.
So Kobe came in and he had a two-touchdown effort, ran for 107 yards. And it gives him – I asked him about it. How does it change? Because you're a lineman, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And for him, he can look at a play and say, okay, this guy's going to go here. This guy's going to go here. And then Coach Surpass said a lot of times what we do is when we put stuff in, he asks questions. Okay, Coach, where's the hole going to be?
Right.
Where do I need to be? And so that's kind of how he's kind of done it. And he gave a lot of credit to Hunter Yu with his pulling against Bogchitta, which they lost 23-20, really close game. But he said he gave a lot of credit to him with his pulling, just disrupting things and opening things up so he could kind of take off. And he gave a lot of credit to the offensive line because, you know, as an offensive lineman, you have to give those guys credit.
Uh-huh.
They're not going to get a lot, but they're getting it done. They got a veteran line, and they were able to get it done. Not necessarily, you know, with the victory that they're looking for. And another part of this is that we haven't touched on this, but Springfield went through all of 7-on-7 over the summer with Brian Babb at quarterback.
Mm-hmm.
So the week of the Jamboree, they learned that Babb, because of, I think it's some family issues, is transferring out.
Mm-hmm.
So they've taken all these reps over the summer with him as their number one quarterback. So that opens the door for RJ Surpass to come in and be quarterback. That is Ryan's son. If you guys don't know, we did a feature on him. You can check it out on our website, LivingstonParishNews.com. Please do. We'd appreciate it. But
thanks for that plug.
Yeah, I got to do it, you know. So it kind of he's had two seasons with season-ending injuries. So this is kind of his opportunity to do things here. So you hate to say it, but they go in and play that Jamboree game, and you know, like I told Coach Surpass, I was like, you hate to say it, but you're pretty much starting almost from square one, you know.
Right.
And they've got a guy for that Jamboree game, Noah Benura, who was their starting center all year last year. They transitioned him to H-back. And so at the end of the game, Coach Surpass calls him over too. And I'm said, you know, Noah, what's the deal? And he said, basically on Wednesday of that Wednesday of practice, they were having some center exchange problems. So they said, Noah, you got to go back to center. No. So he said, I brought the number 53 jersey for the center, and I brought the number 5 jersey in case I had to play H-back. Once again, folks, welcome to 2A football.
That's 2A football.
2A football. And that's just – it's you have to give the coaches credit because they figure it out.
Right.
Because they have to.
Right.
There's no other way to do it.
Right. And it's interesting. You know, they've had personnel issues this year, but it looks like there could be a light at the end of the tunnel. A lot of injury issues over the past 4 or 5 years.
That's what – I still go back to 2 years ago when the season ended, and you know, I was talking to Coach Surpass to kind of wrap things up, and I said, so how many season injuries did you have and season ending injuries did you have? And I want to say he said 12. And I said, how many seniors did you have? He said 12. I said, so you just wiped out a class without even trying to do it. 2A football, folks.
Yes.
Welcome to it.
That's how it works. Well, look, Rob, thank you for joining us. William, thank you for joining us. We will be doing this show once a week after these two gentlemen get their interviews in and wrap up the week before, and then we'll be talking about the week upcoming for these football games. We'll be doing it every week for the 10-week season, and then, of course, we might spice it up a little bit with the playoffs. We're also trying some different interview styles with these coaches. Might be splicing in some audio later in the show as we kind of get our feet underneath us. Might be splicing in some video as well, but there'll also be video interviews coming out if not this week, then next week. We'll be getting them out on Facebook and on our website. You can check that out, www.livingstonparishnews.com. Please check us out there. As he said, it's $5 a month. We're also $10 a month in print, or you can pay $99 up front. You get it twice a week for a year. Again, this is the Livingston Parish News football show. Couldn't get all the coaches together for one time during the week, so we're going to interview them, do this show on a weekly basis. Thanks again for joining us. We'll see you next time.